team. And then, as you can see, the team which organized by different groups, the first by the Decathlon Summit team, and the second by, it is a seminar organized by the Study Commission on Ancient Science and Technology in India. So I think he's going to give an announcement, and I hope these details are correct. They will be confirmed as well. So the second will actually borrow quite a bit of presenting here in the lecture on science. It's not very new for those who attend here. Now, for today, this is, as you have seen, the topic I chose for my conclusion. It is a logical enough topic in the sense that we have conducted a certain journey through Indian civilization, some of its manifestations, some of its accomplishments. But then it's only the past, in a way. And the question is whether we can draw useful lessons or useful applications sometimes. And help solve the problems, the challenges rather, that India is facing today. I want to go further and straight away propose that if the answer is no, this question, no, there is no way that ancient India can help today's India. This is all in the past and it's beautiful perhaps, or maybe not always beautiful, but anyway it was what it was. And but this has no connection with our current situation. If that is the case, we would have to conclude that what we call Indian culture is dead. Because a culture that cannot offer solutions, I won't say solutions, but rather inputs, suggestions for solving actual problems is not a living culture. It is something that is stuck in museums, or maybe you know, some monuments for foreign tourists to visit. But there is nothing living about it. So this is the whole question, and this is a question that you know, I have tried to often reflect upon, especially when I was dealing with students, young students in universities or IITs or elsewhere. And this is in fact the question that they had in the back of their mind, even though they don't formulate it so clearly or so bluntly. They you know, want to know if there is any relationship with the world that they live in today. And very often they don't find it. So therefore they declare that this culture is useless. It's fine for you know, for my grandfather perhaps. Or maybe I'll look into it once I'm retired, but in the meantime, you know, I need a degree, I need a job, so let's be realistic, we don't need any of this. So this is a fairly cynical but understandable also attitude, and when it's my job to try and you know, put a few seeds of thought into such minds. Let me begin by this quotation, and if somebody can give me the author, I will give a virtual or symbolic award. Students in India should be taught about the great ancient Indian mathematicians like Panini, Pingala, Hemachandra, Aryabhatta, and Bhaskara. Their stories and works inspired me, and I think they would inspire students across India. Many of these works were written in Indian languages in beautiful poetry and contain important breakthroughs in the history of mathematics. Anyone who would like to reserve a guess?
Rajendra Prasad?
No. Let me tell you, this is in the... I will give you a big clue. This is in the last 6 months. So this young mathematician, very brilliant, of course, had no qualms in saying what actually sometimes equally bright scientists like here in India kind of discreetly keep on the margins, which is that he was inspired by Sanskrit, he was inspired by the history of Indian mathematics, His grandfather was P.L. Bhargava, a very famous and extremely learned Indologist, who lived in Jaipur a long time ago, but monumental quantity of books and translations of texts and so on. And not only takes tradition from Sanskrit and from this German, but as you all know, also probably from music and tabla in particular. And he finds actually certain links, this is what he explains in the wrong interview, certain connections between all this, between the world of music, the world of Sanskrit, and this is what he mentions. Pāṇini among the mathematicians. Pāṇini, strictly speaking, was not a mathematician. But his grammar actually follows a kind of totally consistent and complete system which can easily be translated into mathematical language, which is why computer scientists have used, especially people have used the Pāṇini's grammar to, you know, design softwares to learn India's natural languages, because it's a totally consistent and complete system. So Manjul Bhargava has declared this kind of inspiration, which his gratitude, let us say, to those elements of Indian culture, which to him are deeply related, music, Sanskrit, mathematicians, it's all one word, and when he says that, you know, it has inspired him. So if it inspires Manjul Bhargava and it ends up in a very concrete result, which is a Fields Medal, why can't we, you know, as he says, why can't we use something of this and communicate it to Indian students? I do believe that if it was done intelligently, that is to say, not in a mechanical dead manner, but in a way that brings out the genius of these people in a very living and why not entertaining manner, I think Indian students would respond. And this would be certainly one way that they could be. So my first observation, and I'm going to just take six categories of, let us say, achievements of ancient India that, to my mind, are very relevant today or can supply really food for thought, but sometimes methods, sometimes solutions, or at least inspirations. One is these knowledge systems that we have. And these knowledge systems are they deserve to be studied for two reasons. One is that they give us a tremendous amount of self-confidence. We see all these great achievements, let me list a few of you know, this tireless creativity, Pāṇini's grammar I have mentioned, mathematics, I have spent quite some time on it, and some of these important contributions of India. The huge area of artistic creation, which at least we are somewhat familiar with. This is one field which has somehow remained vibrant in India, whereas other fields have been restricted to scholars. An enormous amount of literature, but we always forget that actually much of it is lost. What we see is only the tip of an iceberg, and yet that tip is enormous enough. Ayurveda is a shining example of an ancient knowledge system, and we have to call it knowledge system because those of you who attended the lecture by Dr. Rama Jayasundar yesterday would have felt, you know, the strong theoretical background. It is one core theoretical system. It is not just empirical, it is not just a set of recipes that your grandmother would, you know, remember, which also has its own value, but it is more than that. So this is one shining example, of course, of a system which has its full application today, and perhaps will have a growing application. So these are, well, technologies, plenty of them, and political systems. I mean, the list can be extended. Yes?
What would yoga then?
I'm coming to that a little later. Yoga is a little more than a knowledge system. It's a knowledge system, but it's a different kind of knowledge. Here I'm, you know, following a kind of intellectual, the intellectual world of ancient India. But you're right, of course, at a certain level, but I'm coming to that. So these knowledge systems deserve to be studied for several reasons. One, they give us a tremendous amount of self-confidence. These are the creations which emerged from this land. These are the creations for which India often was known in the past. I think I have given enough quotations in previous lectures. And therefore, if that is the case, well, what is preventing us from continuing to generate fresh knowledge instead of using often second or third-hand knowledge? So this is, of course, one. Second, naturally, no mathematician today would be using or would be researching Aryabhatta's mathematics to discover fresh mathematics. That's not going to happen. That his mathematics is completely it is really bad in the past, and it can be studied simply to understand the evolution from a historical point of view of the development of mathematics in India. But in certain fields, there is fresh knowledge. There is still fresh knowledge, and that is what Ayurveda, of course, is one here, but and the arts, of course, but there are other things which could be done. Now, not only that, we need to study those knowledge systems because of the way in which they found their expression, the way in which they were developed. In Europe, this scientific revolution, for example, which emerged in the 12th, 16th, 17th centuries with the Renaissance, was actually a part of the Renaissance. And the Renaissance, as you know, is a French word which means rebirth. It was the rebirth after a dark age of the European Middle Ages. But in India, there was never a dark age as far as the generation of knowledge was concerned. There was never a stop. There were sometimes phases of mild stagnation. But there was no total block or total imposition on the systems which prevented the generation of fresh knowledge. So this phenomenon did not take place in India. It's a different phenomenon altogether. The intellectual tradition is, number one, continuous. In Europe, there are big gaps. In fact, if you look at the first millennium AD in Europe, there's no scientific development whatsoever. Okay? It happens only in the second millennium. So there's a huge gap compared to, you know, ancient Greece, for example. So it is continuous, and number two, it is cumulative. And this is very important. In other words, when a fresh scholar, a founder of a new school of thought, doesn't have to destroy or dismantle or reject what was there before. He builds over it. So this process, of course, sometimes ends up in clearing. For example, Panini mentions eight Grammarians who came before him, who in his opinion were very eminent. But we don't have their works because his grammar so much excelled theirs that nobody continued studying those grammars. So, but yet he built on that foundation. So it is cumulative. It is aesthetical in the sense that there is always a concern for beauty, but not only in the arts. In mathematics, most of the texts are in verse. And some of you might have attended the lecture by Rama Subramanian last week, or 2 weeks ago, where he showed the excellence in poetry that Bhaskaracharya put into his Lilavati, for instance. And finally, spiritual, where we have seen at certain points here and there, even in the notion of the mathematical infinite, in Aryabhatta suddenly declaring that studying the orbits of the planets and the stars will lead you to the realization of Brahman, there is always a spiritual background. So this intellectual freedom resulted in a very lively debate among many schools of thought. I mentioned, for instance, the example of Brahmagupta rejecting some proposals from Aryabhatta and so on. So we have this freedom to argue, freedom to disagree, freedom to reject if need be, and this is what made this creativity so proficient. Education, of course, was at the various education systems, not one or two, but there were quite a few of them in the course of Indian history, where it is what, of course, thought was the foundation for these knowledge systems. And we saw, if you will remember, and this, I think, are points which we keep in mind when we talk about reforming our decrepit educational system. We saw that, first of all, it was not job-oriented, it was knowledge-oriented. The whole goal of education is to acquire knowledge and to develop the personality in a way that we just remind you in the next slide. So it is to develop a human being. It is not to get a job. So somewhere along the line, of course, we have derailed from that objective, but I think it's good to keep it in mind. And secondly, it was not compartmentalized. For instance, these were, if you remember this slide for those of you who were there, the various categories of inner qualities, inner faculties that the student was supposed to develop and acquire. This is one of the lists, there are actually several lists in the ancient text. This is one of the action lists. So it includes moral quality, ethical quality, and spiritual. You see at the end the study of yoga. But there were also outer learning disciplines, which of course were supposed to equip the student not to get a job, but to be knowledgeable enough to be able to participate in this intellectual creation and dialogue. So this was a complete system, and there was no compartmentalization between, for example, in the Vedangas, you have mathematics and astronomy, but you also have grammar, you also have phonetics, you have prosody, and you have the others. So it's all taken as knowledge. Today in class 10 or 11, in most state boards or central boards, if you want to study, to take the scientific line, you have to drop Sanskrit, for example, if you happen to have been a Sanskrit student in earlier classes. You can't do both. It's regarded as, I don't know, incompatible, or somehow, this is exactly the opposite of what Manjur Bhagwan was expressing. You see that there are all these subtle bridges and links between all those disciplines. This is what he felt, this was his experience, and this is exactly what we're destroying through our educational system. So here, I'm firmly convinced that there is a lesson which is still quite applicable. Interestingly, we could use, if we wanted to, which is we're still far from it, but if we wanted to draw the interest of students, especially at school level, towards those intellectual traditions, just to be at least familiar with them and then derive whatever teaching we can from them, this is one line we could adopt. The number of amazing intellectual or cognitive feats that ancient India developed, and these are traditions which are reflected, if you remember, for example, in the list of 64 arts, which I showed you in the talk on education, where we see a lot of puzzles, brain teasers, coded languages, riddles, and a lot of games around all this. And this is something that has come totally out of the education system. And why should it have been? In fact, this is in America, for example, I see many books of about brain teasers, about mathematical puzzles, which sometimes apparently seem to be used by teachers at schools, and they are so stimulating because they allow you to approach these disciplines while playing. We do have this tradition of what is called avadhana. Avadhana means concentration, means attention on knowledge. And we have those people who are called Ashtavadani or Shatavadani, who used to be, there are still a few scattered in India, but this was an established tradition of learning, we used to be able of dividing the attention into 8 or 10 or 100, and you know, multitasking their intellectual cognitive abilities. And for example, you still have a few who perform, and they will receive, for example, they will receive 150 questions from the audience, you know, in a very, very short time. And they will, all the questions will be memorized, and they will give the answers without a break to all the questions. So these are, and I'm going to give you one example, a very interesting anecdote in the next class. I'm coming back to that. The example of Vedic recitation, of course, Vedic memorization is still a living tradition in India. It shows the art of memorization, not mechanical, then memorization, but how, for example, in Kerala, we have been witnesses to some of the last Vedic schools, where young boys are trained totally orally, there is no paper, no pen, nothing, in memorizing entire Vedas, typically Yajurveda or Rigveda. And there are many techniques of memorization so that they will not only remember the text, but they will remember the modulation, you know, the Vedic accent. They will remember the different ways of splitting the mantras. There are 2-3 mantras in Vedic Sanskrit. There will be tests, for example, where 2 competing schools, one typically at Tirchur and one at Kalavaru, which we witnessed once, will be testing each other. So the scholars of one school will test the students of another school. This is known as anyonya, you know, each other. And typically one scholar will draw a particular mantra taken at random in the middle of the Yajurveda to the student of the other school, and they will have to start reciting according to the several modes, but they may also be asked to recite back, for example, to take the mantra and from that receiving mantra. So there are many techniques to ensure an immense amount of mental, you know, agility that we have just lost. This I mentioned. Mnemonic systems, quite a few of them. Let me tell you, give you 2 examples. One is the Katapayari notation, which I don't think I talked about in this lecture series, which is an adaptation worked out in Kerala of the older notation of Aryabhatta, which some of you may remember, this Makhi, 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 and so on. But here, the difference is that this system is absolutely positional. It's an exact equivalent of the numeral system of decimal notation, but this is done totally with the Sanskrit syllables. What you do is that to each digit, each number, you attribute a certain number of syllables. And of course, not in any random order, you can recognize the order of the alphabet. And then you have a choice. For each number that you want to code, you can choose the syllable. And vowels are free. Vowels are free. You can add them as you wish. You can add R, you can add E, whatever you like. The result is that you can, for any given number that you choose, you can actually compose a little Sanskrit sentence or shloka or whatever, and it becomes something which is easy to memorize. In fact, I have a friend, a venerable friend who has done the Veda in his young days, and professor English, ex-professor of English, ex-professor of physics, ex-high priest, ex-many things. And he had this Katapayari system, and this is how he keeps all the telephone numbers of his friends in his mind. Because the telephone numbers are translated into a sentence which may mean, for example, a beautiful garden in bloom, you know, something like that. This would be in Sanskrit. And then all he has to do. So I remember phoning him one day and asking him if I needed the phone number of one of his friends. So I said, just wait a little. I heard him mumbling, you know, something. So I knew what he was doing. So then he translated this syllables back into numbers, and then at the end he told me, this was the days after the STD system had been reformed, he told me at the end, you might have to prefix a 2 before it. He had not updated all this instruments. So at some certain point, all the numbers, a 2 was added before. So, but all the form telephone book is here. So these kind of mental abilities we have lost, and it is a loss, because they would still be very useful to me. This is a historical example of Shankara Varma in the 17th century, and television and astronomer in Kerala, who gives you a shloka to remember the listeners of flying. And you can see this shloka, I'm not going to attempt to read it out. It is a shloka that has some meaning, and it praises the high mathematical qualities, etc., etc. And when you decompose all the shloka and you take it backward, you have the first 17 decimals of pi correctly calculated by numbers which I indicated earlier. And this is just so it's very easy to remember. Whereas remembering numbers, just dry numbers, is not so easy. So this is just, you know, to show you a kind of entertaining aspect, but with a lot of intellectual development behind. Let me tell you the story told by Mark Twain, who visited India in the late 19th century. But before he reached India, on the ship that took him to India, he met somebody actually who had a previous trip to India. And then he records, he actually wrote a travelogue, a very entertaining travelogue called Following the Equator. And he had got into a lot of debts, and the best way he found was to travel around the globe and send weekly articles to some magazine in the US, and that's how he paid off his debts. So he narrates, and I'm going to read it out quickly because it is so striking, you know, of how much these intellectual traditions, the kind of abilities they gave people, and how much we've lost. He says, "The talk passed to instances of extraordinary memory. One of the most striking of the stories told was furnished by a gentleman who had served on the staff of the Viceroy of India. He read the details from his notebook and explained that he had written them down right after the consummation of the incident, which they described because he thought that if he did not put them down in black and white, he might presently come to think he had dreamed them or invented them. The Viceroy was making a progress, that's a kind of exhibition. That's a kind of a journey. And he is received here and there in a very, very, very ceremonial way. And among the shows offered by the Maharaja of Mysore for his entertainment was a memory exhibition. The Viceroy and 30 gentlemen of his suite sat in a row, and the memory expert, the high caste Brahmin, was brought in and seated on the floor in front of them. So you have 30 people and this high caste Brahmin, it's a tautology. He said he knew but two languages, the English and his own, but would not exclude any foreign tongue from the tests to be applied to his memory. Then he laid before the assemblage his program, a sufficiently extraordinary one. He proposed that one gentleman should give him one word of a foreign sentence and tell him its place in the sentence. So he was, for instance, furnished with the French word a, and was told it was the second in a sentence of three words. All right, so the questioner has a sentence in his mind, so this is the second word. The next gentleman gave him the German word Verloren and said it was the third in a sentence of four words. He asked the next gentleman for one detail in a sum in addition. So you think of a sum, say 56 plus 210, and you give one element only of that sum. Others for single details in mathematical problems of various kinds. He got that. All of this is purely oral, there's no pen, no paper. Intermediates gave him single words for sentences in Greek, Latin, Spanish, Portuguese, Italian, and other languages, and told him their places in the sentences. When at last everybody had furnished him a single rag from a foreign sentence or a figure from a problem, he went over the ground again and got, so that was only one rotation of 30. And got a second word and a second figure, and was told their places in the sentences and some, and so on and so on. He went over the ground again and again, and he had collected all the parts of the sums and all the parts of the sentences, and all of them, in disorder, of course, not in their proper rotation. This had to occupy 2 hours. For 2 hours, he was given all these elements. And he now sat silent and thinking a while. Then began and repeated all the sentences, placing the words in their proper order, and entangled the disorder, arithmetical problems, and gave accurate answers to them all. In the beginning, he had asked the company to throw almonds at him, During the 2 hours, he to remember how many hints gentlemen had thrown. But none went thrown, for the viceroy said that the person be sufficiently severe, strained without adding the burden to it. It seems to me that the Brahmin might have been fond of animals, and it was not so much of a strain, an additional strain. But anyway, so this is the kind of feats that this is documented. Many of them have been documented in Indian texts, actually. And this is the kind of abilities that I think none of us is capable of. And why should they be lost? There's no reason whatsoever. I'm moving to a completely different field, which is ecological values and practices, where I will not repeat what I told you during that lecture, but I just want to stress on the viability or relevance of those concepts. First of all, the fact that our relationship with nature is something sacred, and that was very deeply, intensely felt in ancient India, and still is today in some respects, but it's been lost at a fast rate. It resulted in actual forest conservation. I gave examples, real examples of sacred groves, of sanctuaries dictated by Ashoka, for example, or prescribed in Arthashastra. In all kinds of dharmas, in fact, these insistence of forest conservation, on wildlife protection, on water conservation and management, especially if you remember the importance of tanks, more than wells, and irrigation devices. Arthashastra has an entire chapter on this, on the regulation of it. Remember how, for example, water is not free in Arthashastra, it is taxed. So the farmer who uses irrigation works is taxed, and he's taxed more if these are government works, less if these are private irrigation works, but still taxed. Today we consider water to be free, and I think I mentioned, you know, how in addition in some states the power that is used to draw water is also free. So in Tamil Nadu, for example, electricity is free for farmers, water is free. So, you know, what incentive do you have even to switch up your concept after running it for hours? There's no incentive, it makes no difference. And that's why you find, you know, water tables receding very fast. So these are actual valuable indications. I'm not saying that we should apply the same taxation rates that Botinia is describing, but the concept of it is still very relevant. And urgently relevant. Of course, organic agriculture is another very shining example, like Ayurveda, of a set of practices which have been time-tested. After all, Indians were able to feed themselves for thousands of years. Nobody can deny that, though they were occasional famines. But agriculture was, and whatever records we have from ancient texts shows that the yields were quite high to rule. And when somebody like Dharampa has even shown that in pre-British days in one district of Tamil Nadu, Chingalput, the yields were actually higher than what, according to British records, not according to Indian records, than what they are in the same region. So I'm not saying that we should overnight abandon chemical-based agriculture all over India, that will not be feasible. But simply giving more incentive to organic agriculture and allowing the zones you know, dedicated to that to increase would be a very valuable experiment. Well, these are examples I showed of extremely effective, impressive water management system, you know, as far as almost 5,000 years ago. And among all the devices we saw, I think this one, which is the concept of interconnected tanks, that is to say, not simply isolated, not just one tank per village, but all of it interconnected over hundreds of kilometers, as we know was the case in Tamil Nadu, in parts of Karnataka, possibly other parts of India also. This is a very efficient system which distributes the rainwater over a very wide area. I mean, it would be thousands of square kilometers. So I think that, you know, we always tend in India talk about grand ideas, grand projects, big dams, interlinking of rivers at the national level, without first of all testing the or improving the local level, the more regional level. And I think this is something which is cost effective. It has been actually done on small scales in Rajasthan by people like Rajendra Singh, I think I mentioned him. Cost effective, easily manageable, and it can be done with the involvement of the local people. And I think such schemes are not even talked about. State governments do talk about water harvesting systems, and they do talk about drinking ponds, but they have not come back to the concept of interconnected, which is so effective. I want to just mention the fact that all these activities, this is just to remind you, that they're not regarded as simply utilitarian. There is always the utilitarian, of course, is there. Yes, there are wells, yes, there are reservoirs, but there is also some, as I said, I call it spiritual background or some aesthetical background. And look at this stepway, for example, of Rani Ki Wav in Patna, where you go down those huge steps and cross all these tunnels before you reach the well, which is here, a very deep well. And what you find when you reach the well is something, you know, just mind-boggling. You see, the entire inner wall of the well has been stuck with these panels of statues which are curved. And how were they curved, with what kind of calculations, how were they brought into place, how were they erected there, how were they secured in place so that they would remain for hundreds of years. Of course, some of it has been crumbling, as you can see. I mean, this is just my problem. Today we cannot, we don't have craftsmen who can do that. So, you know, every square foot of the wall of the well is occupied by sculptures. There are, of course, as you go down, there are very large panels like these with the statue, magnificent statues. But these are, of course, more easy to realize from an artistic or technical point of view. Thirdly, I want to spend a few minutes on the Indian ethical system. I dedicated a whole lecture to this, so I'm not going to repeat what I said. But I think I made a case that in the present crisis of ethics, as people call it, the Indian value system has some role to play. I just want to take this one example, I forget whether I have time to develop it, of what we could call today interfaith dialogue or inter-religious harmony. And here Ashoka gives us a very specific recipe. And he says, and I think this is all perfectly relevant today, he says there should be growth in the essentials of all religions. Growth in essentials can be done in different ways, but all of them have as their root restraint in speech. This is very important. That is, not praising one's own religion. You're not to, whatever religion you may have, whatever faith, you're not to praise it too highly. And also condemning the religion of others without good cause. And if there is cause for criticism, so he accepts the principle that you may criticize another's religion or another faith or another belief, but it should be done in a mild way. It is not to be done in a, you know, aggressive manner. But it is better to honor other religions for this reason. Whoever praises his own religion through excessive devotion, what we might call, you know, zealotry, and condemns others with the thought, let me glorify my own religion, only harms his own religion. Therefore, contact between religions is good. All should be well done to the good doctrines of other religions. So you can see how those people had actually thought out these problems. You know, there were obviously frictions between different schools of thought, and they wanted this harmony to prevail. So today we talk about it, but we are timid about giving actual recipes, actual formulas that can be. And here he gives us one. Number four, the concept of sustainable development. Now, that's a huge topic and cannot hopefully do justice to it today. I just want to bring out one example that we do, in fact, for my case. It is the example of Ernest Schumacher. Schumacher was a well-known economist in Britain in the 1960s and 1970s. He was a professor of economics in very eminent institutions, and he was also advisor to the UK government on economic policies. So he was not a kind of cranky, freelancer. And it is to him that we owe the concept, in fact, of sustainable development. The phrase is his. The phrase appropriate technology also is his. So he was a profound thinker well ahead of time. And what was it that concerned him? It is what he called Buddhist economics. He called it Buddhist economics because he had worked in Burma. Yeah, I think he did, if I remember, he did the field work on which he made his PhD or something like that in Burma. And he came in touch with Buddhist concepts. And what he found was that in Buddhist economics, since consumption is merely a means to human well-being, it is a means, it is not an end, the aim should be to obtain a maximum of well-being with the minimum of consumption. And you can extend that to, it's not limited to Buddhism, it is all of the thought system, just as well, Hinduism, Jainism, etc. The less toil there is, the more time and strength is left for artistic creativity. So what he's saying is that today the whole system is key to consumption, the production of it and the consumption, and this actually ends up absorbing all our energies. Modern economies, on the other hand, considers consumption to be the sole end and purpose of the whole economic activity. So he tried hard, but I'm afraid was not very successful, in convincing Western nations that the line that they have taken, which is basically where you put consumption at the center, as he himself said elsewhere, he said you put consumption at the center. It is not that, it is the human being that you must put at the center, not consumption, at the center of economies. So, well, it's a different philosophy, and we have to wait till the present curve has run itself out to see whether we can come back to such concepts. This is a big question, but there is certainly food for thought and still relevant thought in India. My fifth point is, or fifth example, is a more, what shall I say, controversial one. It is what is known as the idea of India. Now, this phrase, idea of India, we've heard it often recently at a lot of seminars dominated by some very prominent Indian intellectuals. I'm not going to give names, it doesn't matter. Where for them the idea of India is basically a secular, democratic state where you allow pluralism, what they call pluralism, that is to say multiculturalism, all cultures should be allowed to live together and so on. And basically, that is the end of it. They don't have much else to say in addition. But whereas it looks nice on the surface of it, when you go deeper, you find that there are major flaws in this line of thought. And the major flaw is that the stress is all on diversity. Endless diversity of India is something we're all familiar with. There's nothing new about that. But where is the unity that we keep harping on when we say unity in diversity? That is not talked about at all. And it is not talked about at all because those of you might remember how I showed, I gave quotations from very eminent people like Jawaharlal Nehru, like Rabindranath Tagore and others to show that this unity is actually the old Indian cross, which they themselves in fact call Hindu. It doesn't matter whether we call it Hindu or Hindu Buddhist Jain with hyphens or Indic or whatever it is, but this is the whole system that arose from Islam. And this was the idea of India in ancient times. It was not just this diversity, but it was the unity behind. And this unity was the concept of a shared culture, a shared heritage, and this is what is completely missing in the new set of thought of some of our intellectuals who insist on the diversity, but without ever discussing the unity. Because this unity to them would be unsecular. It would privilege the older Indian traditions, intellectual, spiritual, cultural, and this is something that they do not want. So well, there is a problem here, because if you insist on diversity without the unity behind, you are actually, in a mechanical system, you have centrifugal forces, but if you don't allow for centrifugal forces, your everything is going to scatter. And in fact, this is something which they say sometimes quite openly. There was a decade ago, the head of the CPM, I forget his name, that doesn't matter, not a decade, 2 decades ago, saying that, who said that, well, India is a beautiful idea, but a completely unworkable idea. It is something that cannot work. And in fact, the historian Romain Tapard was interviewed in French daily Le Monde some 5-6 years ago maybe, and in which he said that our vision of India at the end of the 21st century was actually a confederation of independent republics. So, well, she's entitled to her views, but this is actually the logical outcome of this system of thought, where you cannot see the unity behind. And that is why historians who belong to this school of thought never actually talk about the concept of Indian civilization or Indian culture or Indian heritage. Those three phrases do not appear in their works. So we do have here not one but two ideas of India. And I think the older one is the one that can preserve the unity as well as the diversity of this country. You could see Ashoka about the concept of diversity. But I do not see how the present dominant intellectual line can prevent the atomization of it. Finally, in fact, I thought I would be taking more time, but let it be. Finally, and I'm coming to the point that you made about now, the goal of existence. You see, when I was a student in France, a child in France, I somehow started wondering, what is the goal of existence? What are we here for? And the one thing which struck me always was that at school, and we had a very decent school system with very good teachers and very good methods that encouraged the child to think independently and to express things in his or her own way, without repeating textbooks. The books were not even consulted, they were just read occasionally at home as a supplement. The center of education was not the textbook, it was the teacher. The teacher was supposed to teach, and not the textbook. So anyhow, but I didn't find anybody who was able to teach me the goal of life, the meaning of existence. And to me that was something that should be, number one, not the end of the teaching, but at the very start of it. So, it's interesting that the most ancient text of India, the Rig Veda, gives us, towards its conclusion, in the 10th mandala, it gives us this beautiful, somewhat mysterious or provoking formula, that first of all, we have to become the human being on our own power, which clearly implies that we're not a human. And number two, that we have to create the divine people, the divine beings. And so that is the next step. So this, in the briefest possible way, gives us a certain objective, which of course was developed later by all the later classes of literature, the Upanishads and so on, and a whole lot of great teachers, when Swami Vivekananda, for example, said that we are all potentially divine, and the goal of existence is to manifest that divinity, something of the sort. He was simply, maybe even unknowingly, echoing this concept of the Rig Veda. So this is, of course, an Indian contribution. And it has been consistently asserted through the entire literature, but also through a lot of systems of yoga. And yoga is the actual method to put this into practice. It is not given, you know, just as a nice little formula. It is something that people set out to actually work out in actual practice. And those systems of yoga, of course, belong to many ranges. You can start from yoga, the one that is very popular now in the West. It is spread in almost every Western country. Apparently, it is purely physical. Actually, it is not so. There are of course other aspects to it. And you have the whole say, scale of systems of yoga, which I don't have to tell you about, which caters to the most spiritual part of it. But these systems of yoga, ultimately, what do? They develop your inner being, your inner potential, your inner personality. So here again, we have I won't call it a clash that will be a little too harsh, but we have a contrast between, you know, two concepts, the American concept of personality development, which has become all important, from corporate schools to management schools to whatever, and the Indian concept, because personality development in the common parlance, in its common acceptance, is actually about the outer personality, mostly. Though they do try to go a little deeper at times, it still touches only the outer part of the being. Whereas this system of yoga, or yogas, or yoga systems, aim actually at developing, first of all, the inner foundation of it. So this is something which naturally changes the perspective of life. It changes our very capacities, our abilities, and also it has a lot of practical applications for the simple reason that it allows you to meet the challenges of life. And this is something which actually I'm very alarmed personally at the way. For example, young Indians, it's not only in India, of course, but are totally ill-equipped when they go out of school, when they go out of even out of IITs, totally ill-equipped to face the challenges of life. And the smallest, you know, derailment in their planned, mapped out professional, personal life is enough to pose tragedies, catastrophes of all kinds. I mean, we have very high rate of, for example, criminality among IT professionals, young IT professionals, committing murders or frauds or suicides and so on. And this is something which is alarming. It means that for all their intellectual development, they're just not equipped, they don't actually know what life is or what life is about. So those systems of yoga, I think, are something that people will turn to more and more in a very spontaneous, natural way. And I think the spread of the yoga in particular is the first step. There have been other steps in the West, the development of all kinds of, you know, schools of meditation, of teaching. Of course, good or bad, it's always a mixed bag. And you do have, since it becomes a business and practice, you do have people trying to make the most of it. But I do remember that in the 1990s in France, by official figures, and I have the statistics, in the 1990s, the fastest growing religion according to the French government was Buddhism. Because there were a lot of Buddhist centers, you know, opening up everywhere. And obviously, you know, and Buddhist meditation is actually tough. It's highly disciplined. It requires a lot of effort. And yet people go for it. They go for it because they feel the need. You know, they feel that something is fundamentally missing in the Western lifestyle or in the way the approach towards life. And this is why, in fact, you find the more and more Westerners turning towards things Indian. Again, whether they get the genuine thing or whether they get an adulterated product, that is of course a danger which they will have to face. So I think, to summarize this lecture, I think that these are some of the great areas. There will be others if we want to expand this team. The great areas where India still has a lot to contribute in terms of knowledge, in terms of intellectual practices, in terms of ethics, in terms of actual practices of fields like biodiversity, agriculture, water conservation, and so on, and ultimately in terms of human development in the deepest sense of the term. So I would like to thank every one of you who took the trouble to attend my lectures. I would like to thank the IIT Kanpur for inviting me, its director, Professor Indranil Manna. I would like to thank Dr. Manohar Agarwal and my dear friend Raj Chabra for making those lectures possible. I hope you enjoy some of them. And if a few seeds have been planted here and there, just at least to make you, you know, think afresh about what we call very loosely Indian heritage, I think this will be worth it.